What? Banjo-Tooie and Metroidvania? Is probably what you're thinking, but I think it's something worth considering. I got the idea when my friend Retro Reviver suggested the idea to me in Twitch chat, and I thought about it, and I thought about it some more, and some more, and now we have a script about how Banjo-Tooie could in fact be a Metroidvania. First of all, we have to know what a Metroidvania is, but before even that, we need to know where this word came from. The popular rumour is that the term was coined by video game critic Jeremy Parrish, a rumour that Parrish himself has denied multiple times in various articles and videos. Rather, he got the word from his former colleague at 1UP.com, Scott Sharkey, back in 2003 or around that time. Sharkey used the term to describe Castlevania games that took on the design philosophy of Castlevania Symphony of the Night. Jeremy Parrish, on the other hand, spread the term as a means of identifying games that had similar designs to Super Metroid and Symphony of the Night until it became a staple term, but that's all we really need to know regarding the works of Parrish. Let's go back to the games that started it all. I'm not going to go over the history of Metroidvania games that have existed over the years, but instead I'm just going straight to the titles that define the subgenre. Both Super Metroid and Castlevania Symphony of the Night have a lot in common. Run around and explore an interconnected map collecting power-ups that let you advance further into the world. What's interesting about these worlds is that there's no explicit hub in the center that connects to all the areas, and subsequently, no center area that you have to return to in order to visit another area. You could make the argument that Criteria is a hub in Super Metroid, but it doesn't connect to Norfair. You don't have to go via Criteria to travel between two areas most of the time, and there's even this section of it that only connects to the wrecked ship and Meridia. Additionally, Symphony of the Night's opening area connects to even fewer things than Criteria did. I'm not sure if any part of Dracula's castle could be considered a hub. Super Metroid and Symphony of the Night both have a lot of backtracking to 100% the game. However, any percent completion can vary. Symphony of the Night at any percent can really get you running anywhere at any time, while Super Metroid is a little more tame. The only real significant back and forth part in Super Metroid is going in and out of Norfair three times between finding the high jump boots, Varia suit, speed booster, ice beam, power bombs, and grapple beam, and having the skill to do some good wall jumping and shine sparking can help you skip some of that. Now, if you want to 100% either of these games, you need to go everywhere all the time. The only required pickup in Upper Brinstar are super missiles, which you need in order to proceed. The charge ring helps out too, but you can also get that on your first visit. And then you could theoretically finish the game without ever traversing that part of the map again. However, there are still so many things to pick up that you can't get until you have high jump, speed booster, power bombs and more, and I'm not counting glitches in that. Symphony of the Night is very similar, with this gap in the ceiling very early on, but not being able to get to it until you find the Soul of Bat. Then of course there are power-ups and relics of each game respectively. These things allow you to go deeper into each map, whether it's for progress towards the final boss or just for a smaller pickup like a missile pack or potion. Whenever you pick up a power-up like the speed booster for example, you can now backtrack through the interconnected map to a dead end from earlier and see if your newfound ability can overcome it. In the case of the speed booster, you can now make it past closing doors that you couldn't pass before. Now what does any of this have to do with Banjo-Tooie? Well, you see, these three elements of an interconnected map, backtracking and power-ups slash relics, or in Banjo-Tooie's case, moves, are all present. Seemingly, the first problem with my thesis is that the Island of Hags is pretty much a hub. You would likely return to it after traversing a world, it's got Jiggywiggy's temple where you open worlds, it connects to every world, the list goes on. However, the rest of the game is still interconnected. You can open up passages from Mayhem Temple to Glittergulch Mine to Witchy World to Pterodactyland and back to Mayhem Temple, and that's not even the biggest loop you can make. Try Temple to Hailfire Peaks to Jolly Roger's Lagoon to Glittergulch Mine to Witchy World to Pterodactyland to Mayhem Temple. It's just a shame you can't do that full path backwards. Additionally, there's Chuffy the Train that can take you from most places to most other places. Clarkuckoland is a bit different since there's only one way in or out of it, but it cleverly solidifies the world as interconnected with the map of the Island of Hags below, and there are a few interactions with other worlds even if you don't travel to them. The moves you learn in Banjo-Tooie from Jam Jars enable Banjo and Kazooie to travel deeper into the game's world, which sounds a bit odd since you open worlds by collecting Jiggies. I think there's more to it though. First off, you advance to the next area of the Island of Hags by using learned moves. Using the Grip Grab to go to the plateau, Fire Eggs to get into the Pine Grove, Split Up, Talon Torpedo, Springy Step Shoes, and Claw Clamber Boots. Now regarding Jiggies, simply put, you need the moves to get the Jiggies. Keeping in mind, the existence of the Jiggies themselves obscures a lot of the linearity from the adventure because you can collect them in any order. It doesn't matter which four Jiggies you pick up in Mayan Temples as long as you get four of them and learn Grip Grab and you can enter Gliddergulch Mine. The backtracking comes into play when moves from later worlds can be used to pick up earlier Jiggies. Every single world except for the last two requires something from later. I remember the adrenaline I got from finally crossing this toxic pool in Grunty Industries after not being able to for such a long time. Those are the three things that I identified in Super Metroid and Symphony of the Night that make a Metroidvania, and there they are in Banjo-Tooie. But here's the problem. I don't think I've convinced you of anything. All three of those things do fall short. The only thing I don't like about Banjo-Tooie's interconnectivity is how unambitious it is. I think it could have gone so much farther in a number of interesting ways. One of my favourite paths between worlds are the pipelines in Grunty Industries. There's a connection to Jolly Roger's Lagoon's water pipeline and Hailfire Peaks' sewer pipeline. However, I only favour them when regarding the way the area contextualises them. The fact that the signs are up there displaying the information helped make the entire game world feel a lot more believable. But this isn't my favourite connection overall, because even though the passages exist, if you take them from Jolly's or Hailfire respectively, you can't access any other part of Grunty Industries. You're stuck in this room until you leave the way you came in. It was always so sad to me that there was no way to open those up among all the other passages between worlds like this. Backtracking also has a few hiccup moments, like going back to Jiggy Wiggy's temple 9 times to beat the game unless you're crafty and know how to cut it down. Additionally, every time you cross a roadblock with a new move, you're always getting a Jiggy. One of my favourite things about Super Metroid was the mystery of what I would find when searching anywhere. I didn't know that the space jump was going to be after Dragon, but after making the trek across the acid pool with the sack pack, I saw exactly what I expected, a Jiggy. Out of the three things I've discussed, I believe the moves are the strongest argument because of what I said earlier, but it still has its weak points, simply due to the works of Mumbo and Wumba. Using them requires no moves learnt in Tooie aside from Humba's Globo and Hailfire Peaks. So what's my verdict? I think that Banjo-Tooie is a Metroidvania, but it's not a very good one. I'm not going to criticise Rare for that though, because it's clear they weren't really trying to make a Metroidvania. Although both Super Metroid and Symphony of the Night had launched before Tooie's development started, the subgenre wasn't recognised back in the late 90s and early 2000s like it is today. So what's the point in even talking about all this then? Well, what if these design tropes showed up more in 3D platformers? Exploration-based 3D platforming is in a very troubled state right now. They more or less fizzled out aside from Mario in the mid-2000s. A lot of people thought the genre was coming back with Platonic's Ukulele, but it was met with lukewarm reception. My biggest problem was the world expansion and the fact that there were only 5 of them. I was ready to move on to something new way sooner than the game ever intended, and even though I had enough pages to move on, I found myself nearing the end game way sooner than I thought. Simply put, I would have preferred 10 smaller worlds over 5 larger worlds. My favourite place to explore in Ukulele was actually the hub, Hivory Towers. I thought there was a lot to discover about it, and the shortcuts and passages even had that element of Metroidvania discovery and satisfaction, and the moves only helped enforce that. I'm not a game designer, so I'm not going to claim that I have all the answers, but this is just a few ideas I'm throwing out into the world and, well, maybe someone will listen. I'm Hatwaring Gamer, and this has been Banjo-Tooie is a Metroidvania. So I hope you enjoyed that. It was a little bit different than what I tend to do normally, because like as I was editing this, I did notice that there was a slight difference in my tone of voice, because I think the writing style was slightly different. There weren't as many jokes, and it was more thesis orientated as opposed to just talking about a video game for whatever amount of time I feel like. So, as normal, I'd like to thank the patrons right here. And to like, kind of like, back off right there, because like I want to feel the names and stuff there. I don't want to say their names because I'm worried that like I'm just gonna get a brand new patron in between now and when this video comes out, and then like I won't say the name, but they'll be on the screen and stuff like that, and it'll be like so embarrassing and weird, so... Also, I'm looking at notes, by the way, on my phone. You can't really see my phone there, it blends into my top. It's actually a really nice skivvy, because like... It's got like this little bumpy texture on it. I love that for some reason. I don't know why. I try to wear this as much as I can. Probably overworn it a little bit, because I haven't even owned this for... I've owned this for less than 1 year. And, like, oh, there we go. A little thread just come loose. Yeesh. Anyway, couple of also footage thanks to MML for ukulele, and to Nate Conlon on Twitter for the Castlevania Area of Sorrow footage. But he did tell me on Discord that I can call him whatever I want. Someone suggested Nate the Great Mate, but you know, he said whatever, so I'd like to thank Dummy McPoopPants for the footage of Castlevania Area of Sorrow. Gosh, it did not sound nearly as funny as I was imagining it to. Oh, this is where the joke is gonna be. Also, the Rim Shadow's back. Next is a brand new series talk idea that I have. That's really ambitious, and I don't even know if it's going to be good. I'm just going to try and do it and hope that it works. See how people find it. I'm not going to announce it yet, but I'm kind of interested in just seeing how this goes. Like, it's more like I just want to do it so that I can see how it turns out. Also that, I don't know, maybe a video like this exists on the internet or something like that. Yeah, that's like in part one of the reasons why I did made like all the Mario and Luigi videos, because I wanted to watch an analysis of the Mario and Luigi RPG series, like a retrospective series on it, but there weren't any out there. So I was like, all right then, I'll just make one. Now, when is it coming? Probably July, I'm going to say. Like, I know I said that the next video wouldn't be out until July, and it's out and it's May now. Well, first of all, this video is much shorter than I was anticipating it to be. But also... Well, actually, I think that's more or less entirely the reason why. But uni semester does end in the end of June. Although, like, I mean... The classes end at the start of June, then there's, like, the exam period, but... My last exam's on the 24th of June, which is kind of late, but it's fine. I'll still have a nice winter break for pretty much all of July. That should be fun. I'm looking forward to doing stuff. Yay. Don't expect anything before then. I'm not gonna... Like, I didn't even know if I'm gonna spend much time actually working on videos before then. We'll just have to see how it goes. I guess that's really it for now. So I'd like to thank you all so very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video, which will be, I don't know when it'll be. You just have to wait.